Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Several Communist Party activists arrested during police raid in Kenya. ILO reports loss of 26 million jobs in LAC region during the pandemic. Undocumented workers launch second hunger strike for pandemic aid in the US. Israel announces that it will not cooperate with ICC war crimes probe. Felony charges against three anti-racist organizers dismissed in the US. Several activists were arrested during a raid on the offices of Kenya's Communist Party on April 7th. As per a statement released online, police surrounded and then entered the party's headquarters in Nairobi. The raid was conducted without entry or search warrants. Police also tried breaking into a secure room which held official records and documents. Following the arrest on Wednesday morning, the party reported that all activists had been released on bond. They were due to appear at the Kibera Law Courts on April 9th. However, their hearings have now been postponed to April 12th. The party's vice president has stated that the arrested activists do not know what charges have been imposed against them. Wednesday's arrest followed recent mobilizations by the party against the impact of the pandemic on the working classes. Little from the stimulus package released by the government and funded by the World Bank has reached the workers. According to the Communist Party of Kenya, or CPK, the money has been transferred to employers on the assumption that it will trickle down to the workers. Vaccinations and testing have not been accessible to the working classes. Hundreds had also taken to the streets in protest on March 31st. People demanded the suspension of rents, compensation for pandemic-related job losses, and food subsidies. A central demand was also that the government halt its negotiations with the IMF and release all related documents. The next demonstration had been scheduled for April 7th, which was then broken up by the police. Six party members were arrested on the spot and charged with violating COVID guidelines and fined. 26 million jobs were lost across Latin America and the Caribbean in the past 1 year due to the COVID pandemic. By the end of 2020, the region's average employment rate fell from 57.4% to 51.7%. Out of this, 80% of workers, or over 20 million people, left the workforce. These findings are part of a technical note released by the International Labour Organization on April 8. ILO Regional Director Vinicius Pinheiro highlighted a number of issues facing the region. These include high informality, poor coverage of social protection, and problems of child and forced labour. The region also experienced a sharp contraction of working hours and a reduction in labour incomes. These contractions were more pronounced in the informal employment sector. The Canadian CUSO International Group has also noted the rising precariousness of employment for young people. A report by the organization stated that 1 in 6 people between the ages of 18 to 29 have left work. Young people are facing difficulties related to specializations, lower wages, and poverty. Unemployment for people between the ages of 15 and 24 grew by 3.4%. According to the report, these factors also forced many to abandon their studies. In our next story, we go to the US, where undocumented workers in the state of New Jersey have launched a hunger strike. They are protesting against the lack of federal and state assistance during the pandemic. As reported by NJ.com, around 20 people are on strike in front of the State House Annex in Trenton. Advocacy group Make the Road estimated that undocumented immigrants contributed over $600 million in state and local taxes. They have also contributed over $1 billion to the state's unemployment fund. However, they have been ineligible for unemployment and stimulus assistance. The strike in New Jersey began the same day as the hunger strike in New York secured a significant victory. Over 70 people had participated in the Fast for the Forgotten strike, led by the Fund Excluded Workers campaign for 23 days. They were protesting against the exclusion of undocumented immigrants from government aid for pandemic-induced job losses. The state government finally announced on April 7 that it would allocate $2.1 billion in aid. It will establish a tiered system of assistance. Workers who are able to prove that they lost their jobs due to the pandemic will receive one-time payment of $15,600. However, those who are unable to provide such proof will only receive up to $3,200. The system of verification requires documents such as letters from past employers and individual tax identification numbers. While the allocation has been welcomed, campaigners have stated that the amount will not be enough. They had asked for $3.5 billion, which would have been at par with the assistance otherwise given to unemployed people and in the state. Israel has formally announced that it will not cooperate with an ICC investigation into war crimes in the occupied territories. An official statement was released by the Office of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu on April 8th. The state will now notify the court in response to notification letters sent on March 9th. The ICC's chief prosecutor, Fatou Bensouda, had announced the investigation last month. It would examine war crimes committed in the occupied Palestinian territories starting from June 13, 2014. This would include Israeli aggression during the war in Gaza, otherwise known as Operation Protective Edge. Over 2,250 Palestinians, the majority of whom were civilians, were killed during the war. As for Palestinian and UN estimates, another 11,000 were left injured. The investigation will also include illegal Israeli settlements in the West Bank and the confiscation of Palestinian land. The violent attacks against the Great March of Return protests of 2018 will also be included. Palestinian armed groups, including Hamas, have also been named in the investigation. Israel has repeatedly stated that it is not under the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court since it is not a signatory to the Rome Statute. However, the ICC has ruled that it can conduct investigations in Palestine because it has been a state part to the statute since 2015. The court's jurisdiction will extend to the occupied West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. The Palestinian Authority government has announced that it will cooperate with the investigation. And in the final story, we go to the US, where felony charges against three activists have been withdrawn. They were among six activists who were arrested following a protest against police brutality last year. Protesters had gathered to demand justice for Elijah McClain, who was killed in police custody in 2019. The arrested activists were members of the local chapter of the Party for Socialism and Liberation. They were faced with multiple felony and misdemeanor charges, including kidnapping, theft, and tampering. While a district attorney has now dismissed the felony charges, the misdemeanor charges continue to be in place. Here is Eugene Puryear talking to us about this issue in September 2020.
Late the night before and yesterday morning, there was a concerted effort by police in the area of Denver, Colorado, to single out a number of activists, four members of the PSL, leading members of the PSL. And it appears that perhaps some of our allies as well were also targeted. And we're still trying to get the full force of who may have been caught in this dragnet. But they were stopping people at work. One of the individuals, Joel Northam, actually had a SWAT team with an armored vehicle show up to his house to arrest him. Lillian House, another one of the activists who was arrested, was surrounded on the road by five police cars and taken in. So they were taken in a manner that made it seem like they were, you know, multi-state criminals or something that had committed a string of armed robberies or whatever it may be, despite the fact that the charges that have been leveled against them are for peaceful protest. And so the context for this really is that over the past 2 months, there have been a range of protests around the murder of Elijah McClain by Denver Aurora Police, which is just outside of Denver. And the police have been massively embarrassed by this. There have been huge demonstrations, thousands of people, the taking over of a city council meeting at one point, and hours of a very poignant testimony being given by the families of many police brutality victims in Denver and in the surrounding area. And so this seems to come really as retaliation for those protests and for that exposure of the police. And it was done in such a way, and the charges are such, you know, inciting a riot, kidnapping. I mean, these are completely bogus charges, and we could talk more about it, but it seems entirely designed to create the maximum sense of fear, the maximum amount of demonization, and to really try to criminalize the protest movement, because these people are really the most identifiable, or at least some of the most identifiable leaders of this protest movement in the area. And to see them charged like this with these kind of charges and this kind of police response, it seems to us to be really 100% aimed at scaring people from coming out and continuing to protest and continuing to challenge the police. So far, we have not been able to We've only had limited contact with a few people. They're being held, you know, for people to just understand a little bit more. So there's the city of Denver, which people have heard about, and then there's some surrounding counties. And the charges come from at least one of the surrounding counties. We're still trying to figure it out because they're, you know, not giving all the information out. And so the Denver police arrested people and said, well, we're holding them for another county, and then they have to come get them and they have to do something. So they're using a bureaucratic process to try to keep people certainly in jail and not able to get out on bond, and try to keep them incommunicado from us, their comrades, from their families, and from the broader public.
And that's all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.